graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Vampire Hunter D, Volume 7, Mysterious Journey to the North Sea, Part 1, by Hideyuki Kikuchi and Yoshitaka Amano. Translated by Kevin Leahy. Narrated by Scott McCormick, with a full cast.
After midnight, the wind grew stronger. The clouds rumbled as they rolled along. In accordance with the moon's dips under cover, the night alternated between glowing with white light and sinking into pitch blackness. The howl was a cry unlike any she'd ever heard, and it made the girl by the window grow stiff.
Nothing to be scared about.
The master of the lodging house wiped his mouth after another in a long line of cheap drinks. The unlabeled bottle of what seemed to be homebrew was nearly empty of liquid, but filled instead by a dark green surprise. A frog. In these parts, various species of back-leaping frogs were used to bring a full-bodied taste to liquor. But even though this lodging house was near the northernmost extreme of the frontier, it was still difficult for travelers to ignore the local practice.
That's right. That right there is the sound of beast weeds blooming. We don't get many dangerous critters in these parts.
Perhaps put at ease by this, the young woman turned from the window and smiled. It was a lonely little smile that suited the seedy lodging house. Although the 16 or 17-year-old brimmed with a beauty that saved her from seeming too gloomy. Even the dreariness of her shirt and slacks, waterproofed with animal fat, were unable to counter the charm lent to her by the silver comb fastened in her red hair. Out of the collection of 5 rest houses that made up the unbelievably small community, this was by far the most squalid. There was no one in the brick hall save the innkeeper and 3 patrons, including the girl. Add 2 more people, and the room would have been completely packed.
How far are you going anyway, miss?
The innkeeper turned his liquor bottle upside down and shook it.
To Cronenberg.
Now, I don't know where you hail from, but it's a hell of a thing for a lady like you to choose this of all roads. If you were to take the main road instead, you'd get there a whole lot sooner.
It'd be a whole lot more dangerous too, wouldn't it?
The girl covered the leather pouch attached to her belt with the palm of her hand.
The road from the Balistan region to Cronenberg, in particular, is swarming with monsters. I'd rather not run into any mecha beast or mazers or any of those types, thank you.
While the back roads that branched off from the main thoroughfares had fewer actual monsters, they were beset by natural disasters such as landslides, quicksand, and impasses, as well as plenty of human monsters, thieves and bandits of all sorts. Traveling alone, especially for a young girl, wasn't something to be undertaken unless you were quite fearless and well-trained in the use of weapons. And though the girl's facial features still shone with the innocence of youth, one could catch a glimpse of a resolute will in them as well.
Well, if you've come this far, there's just a bit further to go. You should be there by tomorrow evening. Get yourself a good night's rest. Fortunately, summer's almost here. The road's pretty rocky. But I suppose the season will make it a bit nicer.
At the innkeeper's appropriately slurred words, the girl got a faraway look in her eyes.
Yes, summer at last.
Florence!
The girl spun around in the direction of the voice calling from the reinforced lacquer door. Surprise tinged her eyes.
Yes, I thought as much.
The girl noticed then that the speaker sat with the electric lantern on his tilting wooden table turned off, melding with the darkness. Despite the fact they were in a house that was all closed up, the man wore a wide-brimmed hat, as well as a woolen cloak. although the gray hair and beard that hid nearly all of his face testified to his age. The eyes with which he watched the girl brimmed with an uncommon vitality.
There's no reason to pull such a face. It's a simple deduction, actually. You have the smell of salt and fish about you, and the comb in your hair is made from the bones of a lionfish, is it not? That's a local speciality. If you grew up in Florence, I'd warrant you have all the pluck you need to travel on your own. If you'll pardon my asking, just what manner of business sent you to Cronenberg?
The old man's eyes gave off a light that seemed to draw her in, and the girl had to turn away.
Oh, look what you went and did. Now the little lady's all pissed off.
The final voice in the room rose from another window directly across from the girl. The speaker was a young man, and he'd been the very last to come down from the rooms upstairs, though his look of fearless determination fit his muscular physique. The pale line running diagonally across his right cheek couldn't help but lend another impression, a less than reputable one. All present took in the young man's face, but their eyes quickly shifted to his hands. Perhaps the sight of them had stimulated their hearing, for they now heard the sound of the little things sparkling between the fingers of his meaty palms. Squinting her eyes, the girl realized that it was a pair of thin metal rings.
Care to give it a try?
The man grinned as he held out his right hand to her, and the rings spun against one another. The younger man addressed the man by the door.
You don't ask anyone where they're from or where they're headed. That's the rule of the road. For starters, you haven't even given us your name. I guess as people grow older, they get all inquisitive and such, do they?
I wouldn't know. But I suppose it was impolite of me not to introduce myself. You may call me Professor Krolak. It's not an official title, mind you.
I'm Wulin.
The girl offered a bow. It was an ingrained reaction.
I'm Toto. Anyway, how about a little wager, Missy? It's a simple game, really. All you need to do is separate these two rings. Like so.
Reaching for the loose end with his other hand, the man, Toto, pulled in either direction. The rings came apart without any resistance at all. But no matter how closely Wulin scrutinized where she thought she'd seen them disconnect, she couldn't find any opening or break. Toto quickly put his hands together again, and the rings were back where they had been.
You get 3 minutes. The bet is for 1 gold kraken coin.
Those are worth 5 times their face value on the frontier. There's no way I'd be carrying that sort of money.
Good enough. For something else, then. What that pretty little hand of yours has been safeguarding the last few minutes.
Startled, Wulin twisted her body to put her waist out of Toto's view. But at the same time, 2 more pairs of eyes concentrated on her from another direction. They were focused on her pouch.
You're looking awfully pale. Must be rather important to you. If it's not cash, I'd say they're jewels. Or maybe a youth elixir.
And saying that, Toto suddenly got a serious look in his eyes again.
Well, if it's all that precious to you, I won't twist your arm. Whatever money you've got will be fine. I'll still put up 1 kraken coin. And I'm a man of my word.
Orlean's expression shifted. Judging from her wardrobe and her current accommodations, she wasn't exactly traveling in luxury. Kraken coins were produced in extremely limited quantities and were quite valuable. That 1 coin would be enough for her to hire an armed escort and pay for a carriage all the way to the capital.
Relax. Even if I clean you out, I'll at least buy you some breakfast tomorrow morning. Once you've eaten your fill, you'll make it to Cronenberg somehow or other.
His smiling face and equally affable objections served to firm Wulin's resolve.
I paid for my room in advance, but that only leaves me with 4 coppers.
Well, that'll do.
The silvery rings spun around Toto's fingertip.
Okay, there's mine.
His left palm went down on the table and then went away again. The glitter of gold colored 3 pairs of eyes. Taking a seat in the chair across from him, Wulin lifted the lid of her pouch and thrust her right hand into it. Her left hand kept it covered so no one could see inside. The faces of the four copper coins she produced were covered with a patina.
That's the spirit. You get exactly 3 minutes.
Handing the two rings to the girl, he gazed at the magnetic watch around his wrist.
Ready? Go.
As he gave the signal, Wulin focused her entire being on the rings in her hands. On closer inspection, one did indeed have a break in it, but while it had an opening, the gap wasn't half as wide as the other ring was thick. It was as thin as a thread. Yet, Toto had gotten them apart. Relying on her memories of what she'd seen, Wulin tried every possible movement with her hands, but the rings remained hopelessly linked.
3 minutes. Time's up.
As Toto spoke, the girl's shoulders, which were quite solid for someone her age, fell in disappointment. She set the rings down on the table.
I like you, Missy. You're not gonna raise a stink and call me a cheat, are you?
If I did, would you give me my money back?
Sure, why not? I'm not about to give you my coin, but you could walk away with your own. All you'd have to do is give me one itty-bitty peek at what you got in that pouch.
This seemed to be quite a generous offer, and after furrowing her brow for a moment, Wulin soon nodded her agreement. She may have reasoned that because he already knew she was carrying something precious, there was really no point in hiding it. Hers was a rather decisive temperament.
Hey, you guys better not look. This is just us gamblers squaring away a debt.
Toto watched Wulin's hand disappear into the pouch. Her hand came right back out. In it was a wad of black velvet. Brusquely setting it down on the table, Wulin pulled the shiny dark cloth to either side without pretension.
I see.
Rather than being impressed, he seemed a bit suspicious, and more than a tad disappointed. There lay a semi-transparent bead that Wulin could have concealed easily in the palm of her hand. Essentially a sphere, it was marked in places by faint distortions. While the material from which it was crafted was unclear, judging by its dull silver glow, it didn't appear to be any sort of jewel or other precious stone.
Satisfied?
What the hell is it?
As he reached out with one hand, Wulin quickly jerked the bead away, carefully rewrapping it.
It's a kind of pearl.
It came out of the sea, didn't it? So, I guess you came all this way to sell it, then. I hate to break it to you, but that thing...
It's no concern of yours.
Quickly picking up her coppers and putting them in the velvet wad into her pouch, the girl returned to her seat by the window. Back to the sound of the wind and the ever-changing hues of the darkness. At that moment, the thunder of hoofbeats drew closer.
No one passes this way at this hour.
It's a traveler.
Professor Krolok's eyes were still shut.
In the dead of night, he'd have to be funny in the head.
No sooner had Toto spoken than a beastly howl drifted eerily from the opposite direction of the hoofbeats.
They're out! It's those damn bronze hounds! They run in packs of 10 or so. Can't do squat to them with a sword or spear.
We've got to let whoever it is in.
Wulin dashed toward the door, but the innkeeper raced over like the wind and grabbed her tightly.
Oh, no, Yuta. It's too late for that. If those accursed hounds get a whiff of humans, they'll be in here too.
But...
The cramped room was filled with a sort of silence that makes the flesh crawl. The sound of the hoofbeats continued to steadily grow louder, and then they seemed to pull aside in front of the door. Even though the rider had surely heard the hounds, a different sound arose from the end of the road. The clatter of countless paws scampering closer.
We have to help that person.
The innkeeper grabbed his crotch. The girl ran to the door.
Don't do it.
She was reaching for the doorknob, but a split second later, the girl turned right around with her hands still extended and dashed back across the room. Stopping in front of the counter that served as both the bar and the front desk, Wulin was stock still in amazement. but the rest of the group didn't get to see it. For at that very instant, on the other side of the door, wild dogs with hides like blue steel made straight for the poor traveler and his horse. A bladed weapon swung down at the beasts, only to bounce off them in vain. Flesh-rending fangs and blood-spattered muzzles, it was a tragic scene any of them could easily imagine. But a second later, it was over. No one moved or even said a word. After a little while, Toto got up and quickly walked over to the door.
Hey!
The warm nocturnal air was heavy with the scent of fragrant night grasses. The wind struck Toto in the eyes but couldn't tarry there, and the young man caught another of the night scents. The moon was out. On the road, the scenery was a stark contrast of black and white. Black seemed to be the stronger of the two. The smell was coming from a number of pools of blood. The heads and torsos of the bronze-covered wild dogs had already ceased twitching.
One, two, three. Exactly 10 of the beasts, and all of them put down in less than 2 seconds.
Toto gazed in the direction the hoofbeats had gone. The howls of the night wind made his well-trimmed hair and the hem of his coat billow in the same direction.
It might have been him. He can travel by night, and all alone.
Early the next morning, Uline left the lodging house. She didn't even bother to eat. The innkeeper and the other guests were still asleep, and the western sky was just beginning to shine with a watery light. Dressed in the same clothes as the night before, she was shouldering a vinyl backpack. 3 minutes' walk brought the girl to the edge of town. Beyond the fence, a cedar so huge it would take 3 men to get their arms around it, stretched up to the blue sky. In this region, it was customary to grow enormous trees on either side of the main road through town. It was hoped that doing so would bring the community some of the same mysterious vitality the trees possessed. Past the massive cedar, the rows of trees continued. Opening the gate and then shutting it again behind herself, the girl was just about to walk off when someone appeared from behind the foliage.
Professor Crowlock?
A gray-haired head bobbed at the receiving end of her tense gaze.
Good morning, young lady. Off to an early start, I see.
Placing one hand on his chest, the professor bowed elegantly.
So are you. I wouldn't have thought you'd be out before me.
Actually, I couldn't get much sleep. At any rate, if it pleases you, would you accompany me to Cronenberg?
Are you headed there too, Professor?
Actually, I am. My carriage is parked behind yonder tree.
You sure I wouldn't be intruding?
Uline stared intently at him in his scarlet cloak.
Whatever could you possibly mean?
Why ask me way out here?
I might have suggested it back at the lodging house, but there was a certain boisterous individual around.
And you wanted me all to yourself?
Ha! Precisely. Approaching you in town was going to be troublesome, so I simply waited out here. I wouldn't be so cruel as to say I don't care what happens to a young lady like yourself. Please, join me. All I ask in payment is that bead you have in your possession.
I thought as much. Guess it's a good thing I showed it off so no one got too curious and slit my throat while I slept. Do you know what it's worth?
Probably better than that rabble last night.
The professor closed his eyes and nodded to himself.
But as yet, I don't have a good idea of its true value. To really ascertain as much, I'd need you to hand it over to me.
Sorry, I travel alone.
As if in jest, the girl bowed exactly as the professor had. And then a second later, she sprinted off like the wind. The professor didn't bother to chase after the girl as she swiftly dwindled in the distance.
Blah. Such a tempestuous child.
He thrust both hands into his cloak. What they came out with were very strange items indeed. His right hand held a quill pen, and his left hand held a brownish scrap of paper. Or rather, a dried piece of animal hide. Returning to the tree and leaning against it, he raised his right hand. Without seeming to particularly steel himself for the task, he took the sharp tip of the pen and stabbed it into his left wrist, not even glancing at the gore that spread across his skin when he pulled it out again. He took the blood-dipped pen and began to draw something on the surface of the parchment, what looked to be a human face. After about 10 seconds, the pen's movements ceased. Running his eyes over his handiwork at length and nodding with satisfaction, the professor then embarked on an even stranger course of action, lovingly bringing his face closer to the portrait of darkening red. He began to whisper,
"Kanojo no ashi o namare no yo ni suru."
Having already run more than 100 yards, the girl suddenly found her feet getting heavier. A hue of bewilderment rose in her face. While she didn't stop, she had noticed a rather odd phenomenon. Her legs seemed to be gradually losing their strength, to the point where she couldn't run any longer.
Why is this happening?
With those weary words, Wulin squatted down right then and there. Less than a minute later, a wagon drawn by a pair of cyborg horses stopped right behind the girl as she crouched down, cradling her knees. It went without saying that the man who sat in the driver's seat holding a whip was Professor Krolok. The grotesque parchment was rolled up in his left hand.
"You mustn't keep these problems to yourself. I'd be happy to hear them. Won't you climb into my carriage so the two of us might mull over your dilemma? Come."
All exaggeration aside, the old man's tone truly swam with affection. At the sound of his voice, Wulin got up and began to walk toward the wagon without the slightest hesitation. And then something equally bizarre occurred. The professor's right hand abruptly shot out, and with a sharp crack from his whip, the wagon made a wide turn toward town, back the way they'd come. Odd as it may seem, the same professor who'd taken the trouble to follow Wulin then cracked the whip again, and scattering fragments of the dawn's light like so much dust and ice, started off in the opposite direction in a great hurry. As the old man and his wagon vanished down the road, another figure stepped out from behind the trees that towered by the roadside and into view of the paralyzed Wulin. He was leading a horse. His right hand was clearly toying with a pair of gold rings. Waving his left hand before the eyes of the mesmerized Wulin, the mysterious young traveler, Toto, made a wry face.
"He calls himself a man of learning, and then he goes and puts some weird spell on a girl like you. That's really tempting the wrath of heaven. That said, I must confess I'm after the same thing myself. Don't take it too hard. Looks like I was right when I guessed that bead was really something after all. Allow me to be of some assistance."
Wulin seemed to have the very soul drained out of her, and at this point a baby probably could have taken what it wanted from her. Tapping her pale cheek with his right hand, as if humoring her, the man was reaching for her pouch with his left hand when something hot whizzed right by the end of his nose.
"There she is! Don't let her get away!"
Not only could hoofbeats be heard coming from the direction of the town, but the sharp whistles that came from the figures closing on the pair soon became steel arrows in flight.
"Just as I thought. Company. And here that old innkeeper was trying to come off so friendly and all. Now the world's a nasty place. Sorry, but this is where I make my exit."
But as the young man's hand reached once more for the pouch, it was caught by Wulin's. Just as the shock was recoloring Toto's complexion, his wrist was expertly twisted back against the joint and the man was physically thrown a good 10 feet down the road. And yet, the way he executed the skillful 180-degree roll and landed lightly on his feet was truly an eye-opening display of acrobatics.
"Hey, wait just a second."
But just as he was about to charge back to the girl, a number of arrows flew over his head, and as he hit the ground despite himself, the sound of iron-shod hooves reached his ears. A shadowy form leapt over his head. Needless to say, the rider holding the reins of Toto's cyborg horse was none other than Wulin.
"Thanks for the horse! See ya!"
With that brief shout, the girl who'd escaped from the professor's spell before Toto even caught on slammed her right heel into the mount's flank and galloped away as fast as she could. Riding for a full hour at breakneck speed, Orlean was a few miles from an intersection with the main road in an area still lit with the cold, clear rays of dawn before she finally let her horse rest its legs. At any rate, she was probably safe for the moment. She never would have thought those two men would be lying in wait for her, and it had certainly been a mistake to fall under the mysterious spell. But since she'd managed to extricate herself from the situation, none of that mattered anymore. Having acquired a horse in the bargain, it was likely she'd reach Cronenberg at just past noon instead of in the evening. Recalling the stunned look on Toto's face as she'd thrown him, Wulin smiled innocently, but it took less than 2 seconds for that smile to freeze. The sound of hoofbeats was again growing nearer. She thought it might be the professor, but there was no squeak of wagon wheels. What she saw were a number of horses and racers at that. They wouldn't be out delivering mail at this hour. Was it the last group that had shown up as she was leaving? Just as Wulin was about to give a kick to her mount's flanks, something whistled through the air as it dropped toward her. Spark shot up on the right half of the road, about 10 feet ahead of her, and a fierce shockwave knocked both horse and rider down on their sides. It was the work of a portable firebomb launcher. An expert could hit a target the size of a brick from over 200 yards away. But if they were only trying to blow something up, all they had to do was increase the amount of gunpowder. Wulin immediately got up. For the time being, her foes were only trying to slow her down. And fortunately for her, they seemed to be concerned about damaging the bead and had adjusted the amount of gunpowder accordingly. As a result, the girl hadn't been fatally wounded or even broken a single bone. As Wulin tried to get her horse back up on its feet, the urge to vomit was building within her. In truth, she'd taken a blow to the stomach when she fell, jamming a finger down her throat. She vomited. She realized her horse was a lost cause. Its neck was twisted grotesquely. If it had been one of the models cherished by the nobility, it would have continued to run even if the entire head had been torn off. But this one was intended for humans. Wiping her lips, Wulin shouldered her bag and looked around. The woods were thick to either side. Behind her, the silhouette of riders formed hazily in the white light. She couldn't afford to hesitate. Wulin ran to the right. The woods might serve to restrict the movements of horses. The trees and bushes would probably provide her with some cover from the explosives as well. Just when she thought she'd knelt into the grove of trees, an impact slammed into her from behind, and a sharp pain shot through her back, probably a branch or a small stone. The next thing she knew, she was lying on the ground. Putting all of her strength into her limbs, she tried to get up. Right behind her, she heard a familiar voice say,
"Give up already! We'll make it quick for you!"
It was the innkeeper. Wulin got up without looking in his direction. About 5 yards ahead of her was a thick grove. How many seconds would it take me to get there, she wondered.
"We don't want to blow that doodad of yours to kingdom come, you know. So we won't finish you with the mortar. What do you fancy? A sword or an arrow? Or would you prefer we garrote you?"
Wulin started to make a break for it, and then someone new stepped out from behind a tree. The newest arrival was a dashing figure. He wore a wide-brimmed traveler's hat and a black long coat that sheathed his tall form elegantly. The long sword on his back had a graceful curve to it. For a second, Wulin had to wonder whether it wasn't a moonlit night at present. But the reason she and the men behind her froze was because they unconsciously knew that an aura of extreme danger lingered around the gorgeous stranger.
"Who the hell are you?"
Wulin swiftly circled around behind the figure's back.
"Help me! They're bandits!"
The stranger didn't move.
"Out of the way, pretty boy."
There were half a dozen men on horseback, with the innkeeper leading the pack, and all of them wore vicious scowls. Surely their racket consisted of finding travelers with something valuable, then following them when they left and killing them. They were armed with swords and spears, but the man to the right was the only one with disc-shaped bombs loaded into a crossbow-like launcher pointed at the ground.
Well, it doesn't really matter. Now that he's seen our faces, it's not like we're about to let him live. We'll send him to his reward along with the girl. Just consider this your brief romance, and kiss each other goodbye.
As she listened to his cruel words, Wu Ling clung tightly to the back of the shadowy figure. But something suddenly became apparent. The man in black wasn't looking at the other men. At the end of his gaze was a grove of trees and sparkling green leaves. Between him and the other men, faint beams of light swayed, sunlight peeking through the trees. Wu Ling looked up at his profile. There wasn't a hint of sadness on its face. It put Wu Ling's heart at ease. Broad swords and spears glittered in the men's hands. They charged the stranger. Still, Wu Ling remained entranced, enchanted by the beauty of this strange young man. Hammering the earth between them, a pair of riders raised by the stream.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.